Welcome to Now Church. We are about to begin. Please take this opportunity to pull out your smartphone so you can like, share, and check in on our social media platforms, including Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. And please use the hashtag NowChurch. Thank you, and enjoy today's service. Ocala, Florida, horse capital of the world, where the dawn of a new day brings a fresh opportunity to chase history, a bloodline destined for greatness, groomed from birth, trained to triumph over obstacles, powerful, graceful, majestic. It's here strength is tested. It's here endurance pushed to the limits. It's here champions are made.
A Burns and Aliar hits the bird. A Burns got a nose in front of him. Come on to the wire. At the finish point, he gets tight.
And here it is. The 37-year wait is over. American Pharoah is finally the one. American Pharoah has won the Triple Crown.
Watching these gentle giants ride to victory is truly a thing of beauty. But as a human being, it made me reevaluate. Who am I? What is my purpose? How can I win in this race called life? The journey led me to Now Church. I'll never forget the first time. Hands lifted high, voices raised. A real encounter with Jesus Christ, an expression of love, an atmosphere of faith, a passion for others, all ages, all colors together as one, for a cause greater than ourselves, serving our neighbors and reaching our world, to know God and make Him known. It didn't take long to realize this is where I belong. People, reaching a now generation with a now sound and a now word.
Good morning, Now Trash. You came on a great day.
Thank you. starting your week right here in the presence of God. Yes, that's the best way to start out. We're celebrating so many different things. And we just want to encourage you, as we take this time, we're going to pray over a certain prayer request. And I just want to encourage you, you're in the right place at the right time. Thank God you're in a place that believes in prayer. We believe that God answers and He is always active on our behalf. Nothing is too small or too insignificant. Nothing is too great or too big for our God. Amen? And so we have some things that we want to pray for this morning. We have someone that's believing God. I believe this is a great request. They're believing God for job advancement so that they would have a better schedule to attend services every single Sunday. I believe that. I agree with that. When you get your heart set on being in the house of God, He honors that. So also someone believing God for financial breakthrough. We've had so many people just celebrating financial breakthroughs or job placements or promotions. You know what? God, these things are not too big for Him. We believe that? So let's just join with me right now as we pray over these things right now. And we believe that we're bringing things from heaven down into earth. And Father, we thank You, Lord, for the opportunity, the joy, the privilege of standing with others in faith to believe for a breakthrough. Father, we thank You healing and lives. We thank You for restoration of families. We thank You for job placement for this person that's believing specifically to honor You and to be in Your house. Father, we pray that You would have to, if whatever You need to do, move mountains, move situations, whatever You need to do to put this person in a good position. Father, we pray for financial breakthrough to continue to sweep through this house. Lord, blessing and abundance and favor be on our people here in the name of Jesus as we're stirring our faith. We believe You and we trust You to bring forth the answers now in Jesus' name. Amen. Come on, let's give God praise. Amen. I am so happy to be a part of Now Church, not then church, not was church, but Now Church. It's Now Faith. So we're glad that you are here. If you're checking out churches and this is a newer experience for you, we always put out a three-week challenge, which is simply this. Check this church out 3 weeks in a row, consecutively, and see what God does in your life, and we believe that He may be calling you home right here. We'd love to see that. Also, we have next steps, a new round taking place this Sunday, and it's going to take place in the second service. It's all about Know God the first week. It is worth your going, getting a donut, and coming back. But stay here for service, and then go get your donut and get back here, and then we'll have a great time at Decide Know God. It's a good time to really just see what the next level in God is. Are you ready just to worship God even more? There's so much more, so many more things we need to praise and worship and go for and just give up our praise right now to our God.
Thank you. Oh, worship. Take your mind of all the things that are going on outside and place your eyes on God.
It is a mercy, Lord. Sing it again, Dakota. Through it all.
Through it all, through it all, my eyes are on you. Through it all, it is well. Through it all, my eyes are on you, and it is well with me.
We're almost done, we're almost done, we're almost done, but there are people in this room. Know it by the Spirit of God. There are people in this room that need to know, no matter what all the stuff looks like, it is well. Come on, it is well. Well, my eyes above what it looks like, my eyes above what it looks like. Something's changing in the Spirit. Something's moving, I can feel it. Up your hands all over the building. Somebody needs it, somebody needs it, somebody needs it. Oh, you need to know that our God is faithful, our God is able, yeah. She's gonna sing it over you, she's gonna sing it over you one more time. Through it all, sing it.
And through it all, my eyes are on you. And through it all, through it all, it is well.
Yes, it is, Lord.
And through it all,
yeah.
Through it all, my eyes are on you, and it is well with me.
Hallelujah.
Come on, we're clapping for Jesus today. Come on, let's praise him.
Hallelujah.
Come on, give it up. Come on, let's worship him. This is for you, Jesus. We love you. We bless you. Come on, act like you only got your breakthrough. Come on and praise him. Jesus, this is for you. We love you. We bless you. We honor you. All honor, all glory, all praise to you, King. In Jesus' name. Turn to somebody and tell them, I was made to praise him. Tell him right now. Come on, greet some people around you. Love them and love each other today. We got a brand new theme this month. Some of you know the tune there anyway. It's going to be a great, great month this month. We're talking about some awesome things. You know, one of our biggest prayer requests back in when we had our Heart for the House offering a few months ago, one of the biggest patterns, and I read every prayer request. We prayed over every prayer request. And our pastors prayed over them every day that month. And one of the biggest things that it would just break your heart to see is so many people praying over relationships. Relationships that are strained, relationships that are broken, relationships that just aren't where they're supposed to be. And I'm talking about not just marriages, I'm talking about just even friendships or family relationships. And so I've been spending this summer just kind of drilling down to some fresh things we could talk about when it comes to relationships. Okay, so we're going to talk about that. Open your Bibles to Judges chapter 14, if you will. I want to talk a little bit about Samson, but not the typical story. Most everybody knows the story of Samson with Delilah. We're going to talk about that just very little bit. I want to show you the patterns of Samson's life. Judges 14:1 says, "Now Samson went down to and saw a woman in Timnah of the daughters of the Philistines." There's a whole story going on. I'll tell you the story in a few moments. But he ended up falling in love with that woman and asking his parents to fix him up with her. And he married that woman. And it turned out to be a tragic, tragic story. It was very, very tragic, affected the rest of his life, in fact. But it starts with, now Samson went down to Timnah. Judges 16:1, now Samson went to Gaza and saw a harlot there and went into her. Now, I don't know if you're familiar with Gaza. That was where all the clubs were. That they shouldn't say this. You know, you've heard of the Gaza Strip. Yes. See if you're awake. Three people got it. Verse 4, skip down to verse 4. Afterward, it happened that he loved a woman in the valley of Sorek. So, tell somebody, Samson got around. He went too many places, and he always found the wrong person when he got there. After what happened, he loved a woman in the valley of Sorek whose name was Delilah. This was a man of God, understand. This was a guy dedicated from before he was born and took a vow before God, even presented by his parents, to be a leader, to bring change, to protect his nation. Verse 5, the lords of the Philistines came to her and said to her, entice him, find out where his great strength lies and by what means we may overpower him, that we may bind him to afflict him. That's the devil's plan for you too. Trying to find the secret of your power that he can bind you to afflict you. And every one of us will give you 1,100 pieces of silver. This woman was going to get rich by getting with Samson. Finally, Proverbs 13:20 from the Message says this, become wise by walking with the wise. Hang out with fools and watch your life fall to pieces. Let's pray together one more time. Father, would you open the eyes of our heart today and grant us hearts that will receive, perceive, and believe in Jesus' name. Amen. Our theme this month, friends, is about the search for intimacy and community. Did you know that every one of us was born with an innate desire for intimacy, intimate relationships, and community? And the problem is, in the world we live in, we have a lot of things going on that are trying to keep us from both community and intimacy. Last week, we finished a powerful series with a teaching on soul ties, about emotional and mental bonds that need to be broken by faith, and it's really given birth to our next series simply called Friends. I realize we've never done a series using this iconic TV show, Friends, because we're called Now Church, and that's about to be 24 years old next month. But it's interesting because as I go around the world, it's still the most popular syndication. I mean, when I was a little boy in the 60s, it was I Love Lucy was everywhere. Okay, we could see it. It was in reruns. I thought we were watching it first run, but it was 10 years almost before I was even born. And today, Friends is having that kind of impact. You can turn on a TV somewhere in the world at 24 hours a day right now, and you can find Friends. When I was in Bulgaria, it was hilarious because they had them speaking Bulgarian. And it was so funny to, you know, to hear Joey, how you doing? But he's doing like, brada bo, slava bogo. And the different catchphrases and all the different things that they did. I've seen it this year in Germany and in German translation, Bulgarian translation, in England, and they love it in England too. And then the other part's interesting to me is millennials are now watching Friends even though it's older than they are and identifying with these six types of people in their lives. And part of it's the nostalgia for simpler times and searching for community. Who had ever thought, those of you that are over millennial age, who had ever thought the 90s would be considered the good old days? Okay? Like it was easy and it's so easy back then. It really wasn't. It's just, you ever notice on a sitcom like Friends, now, have you ever been, anybody been to somebody's house in New York? They go into the place and they shut the door and they lock 10 locks, but not on Friends. It was unlocked. The friends could just walk in and out of each other's apartment, and part of the funny jokes were they just walked in. And that's not real life. In real life, you got to lock your door. In real life, you got to deal with getting up when somebody knocks on it and looking out the peephole. Understand that life isn't a situation comedy, but I think we long for those days. One of the things we've always tried to do at Now Church, and hopefully you feel it, is to answer questions people are actually asking in our preaching. One of the things that bugged me kind of growing up is that I felt like I was getting sermoned to, preached at, with messages that didn't interest me. There was nothing in me that resonated with some of the Presbyterian tradition that I grew up with, or the Methodist church when I was young. And you know, when they preach the gospel, Jesus is always relevant, but I didn't hear a lot of Jesus preaching. I heard a lot of moral platitudes, moralism. You know, love your neighbor, be kind to animals. Well, that's real powerful, you know. Save the whales. You know, the word says Jesus came to seek and to save the lost. And I'm not against the whales, but they got to save themselves. Somebody can stand up for the whales, but understand this. At the end of the day, saving a whale doesn't make an eternal difference. What makes an eternal difference is touching a life, a human life, with the power of God, okay? Don't get upset with me. Some people said, maybe groan when I said, look, I'm not against whales. I'm not against, but eventually you realize that as good as it is to be kind to animals, there's no life-changing truth in that. You should do that, but that's not going to change your life. Relevance, our vision is over here. Some of you read it sometimes. Some of you stop reading it because you come in, you don't even see it anymore. Building a relevant, that's one of our first words, building a relevant creative church, empowering people to reach other people. Well, relevance is a big word, but relevance, what is it? Relevance to me is simply, it's a matter of discovering how to apply the scriptures to everyday life. It's how do you apply eternal truth in 2018 and beyond. There's no important and practical subject than relationships, friendships. I was reading recently, one of the speakers at our conference this week, I was in our annual conference for WAVE, we're part of WAVE Collective, great network of churches from all over the world meeting together in Virginia Beach, Virginia, at WAVE Church up there. So I was there all week. Dr. Ed Young of Dallas, Texas, Fellowship Church in Grapevine, Texas, great man of God. And I've heard him preach many times, and I've got several of his books and things, and so I was so stirred by his preaching, I got one of his books, and I was reading it, which really was helpful. But I remembered him telling a story a few years ago of a friend of his from high school named Larry, and he said they weren't real close friends. They were friends. They were on the same sports teams, and so they're acquaintances. How many know there are levels of friendship, right? And we'll talk about that this month a little bit. Not everybody should be in your inner circle just because they're an acquaintance. And you got to be discerning on that. But this guy, Larry, was just a friend playing on sports teams together. A few years after high school graduation, by the time Ed Young was already in ministry, an old friend called him up one night and said, "Are you sitting down? Have you heard about Larry?" He goes, what about Larry? He said, "Larry just got convicted of murder." Like an old friend from high school, murder. It blew him away, and he just... 2 weeks later, he found himself sitting in the prison yard with Larry and just talking a little bit. And he said, "Larry, tell me, when did the wheels start coming off? Like, when did it start to go bad for you? Because we knew each other. We played basketball. We played baseball together. You were a good kid. You were doing decent in school and good guy. Where did it start to go bad for you?" He said, "Larry said these four words that Pastor Ed has now heard, and I've heard too many times. I had these friends. I had these friends." Where did it start to go bad for you? Where'd the wheels start coming off? "I had these friends." If you look back at your life, I'll almost guarantee you that some of the times that you went to the wrong places, it was because of the wrong people. And if you look at your life and where things started to get tough for you, if you'll be honest with yourself, you had these friends too. And so we need to talk about that. How do you form the right relationships? How do you break free of the wrong ones? Some of the worst decisions you ever made, or some of the moments that went on to produce the most heartache, couldn't you also say, I had these friends? You know, people talk about they. People come and say stuff, you know, well, they said, well, they, the, you know, everybody's talking about, you introduced me to your they, and I don't have to be a prophet of God to predict your future. You introduce me to the they. Because, you know, studies show that you are becoming like the five people that you spend the most time with right now. You are, I mean, they say you can't teach an old dog new tricks. I'm telling you, we're all a product of the people that are in our lives right now on a regular basis. And whether you like it or not, your values are moving toward their values. Now, you need to be the biggest influence there. But don't use that as an excuse. If you start to see yourself being pulled in a wrong direction, you need to make some decisions. Amen. Show me who they are. Most of you know at least a little bit of the story about Samson. Dedicated to the Lord before his birth, as I said, angels announced a special calling on his life. He made a vow as he got to be older to serve the Lord, and he received a superpower. The anointing on his life was strength, physical, raw strength. He could do things with his strength that nobody could do. He was literally the strongest man in the world at the time, a physical specimen of a man. But his insides didn't quite match his outsides, did they? So when he gets to be a certain age, he starts pining away for the wrong things. You know, some of the most important things you'll do in this life have to do with the big three, what I call the big three. And remember, what is a noun? Remember nouns? People, places, and things. People, places, and things. Guarantee you, if we hang around with the wrong people, we'll end up going to the wrong places. And we'll wind up doing the wrong things, Ed Young said. Amen. I'm telling you, that's the truth. Leave that up there for a moment, if you will. Because I want the young people to read it. And I want the older people to read it too. Samson's unhealthy pattern is he kept going to the wrong places time after time. Where did the wheels start coming off, Samson? Before you lost your vision, before you found yourself weak and broken and losing your superpower. Where to start going wrong, Sam? Not with Delilah. Now he went to Timnah. Now Timnah itself, the name Timnah doesn't mean some evil thing, but it is interesting. Timnah literally in the Hebrew means a part or portion. And I would say this way. So Samson went down to settle for a part or a portion instead of the whole thing. So Samson went down to Timnah, and there he saw a beautiful woman from the Timnites. But it was a city that was known for rampant sexual immorality and seduction. And here he was, called by God to be the leader. Basically, before the days of the kings of Israel, the book of Judges is all about judges who were positional leaders. They were not passed down from king to king, but they rose up by the power of God. And this guy was basically the king of Israel. He was a de facto king of Israel before there were kings in Israel. And as the leader of the nation, he kept subjecting his life to all kinds of pain by running to these places. He found there was an unholy attraction. Remember Lot, Abraham's nephew? And the Bible says that Abraham said to Lot, look, you got so many cattle, I got so many cattle. Why don't you choose a direction and go any direction, any of the cities around us, and you can go wherever you want to go. And that God says that'll be your land. And Lot looked around, and the Bible says, and he pitched his tent towards Sodom and Gomorrah. He could have gone anywhere, but there was an unholy attraction. And I'm telling you, there's a chemistry within every person. You got enough nitro in you. If you get around the glycerin and the people with the glycerin, there will be combustible explosion. Okay, there will be something either in the wrong way or in the right way. But you have a choice. God doesn't make you choose that. Here was a man of God with the call of God. But I'll tell you what, the worst place for a he man with a she weakness was Timnah. And he goes down there. Listen, he probably said to himself, just this once, I'm just going to go to Timnah. I'm just going to go for a visit. One of our speakers in our conference the other day was a Christian psychologist who deals with pastors and leaders and even Christian Fortune 500 company CEOs. And he just said they get calls, they deal with thousands of Christian leaders a year that are in crisis, from the famous to the, and the rich to the unknown. But he said the stories, and he was urging us as pastors to watch our habits and watch out for what we set before our eyes and what's set before our hearts, and that we guard our marriages and our relationships. And he said this: the devil will always take you a lot further than you wanted to go and keep you there a lot longer than you meant to stay. Everything begins and ends with one word: curiosity. When you become curious for the wrong things, the enemy is working to bring attractions to the wrong things. And if you don't deal with it at the level of the curiosity, there's a drift. He said to us pastors, he said, guess which day of the week we get the most calls from around the world from pastors that are in crisis? And we all knew, Monday. Because Sunday you go, God anoints you even if you're a jerk. In his mercy and his love, He puts his love, his grace. Samson moved in power even after Timnah. Let me tell you what happened in Timnah, by the way. In Timnah, Samson said, I want that girl. And when he went to marry her, they had this marriage feast, and the men of Timnah were afraid that Samson was going to destroy them. And so they went to his wife and said, we will give you money. This is before Delilah. The same exact story that happened with Delilah and the Philistines happened with his wife and Timnah. And if you know that, it was exactly the same thing. They offered her money and said, we want to find out the secret of his power. And at some point, Samson was boasting at the wedding party and said to the men of Timnah, I've got a riddle for you. And he had just been through an experience where he'd walked down the road and a lion tried to assault and kill him, and he killed the lion. And when he came back by the lion, the carcass was laying there, and there was some bees had nested in there, and there was honey inside of the carcass of this dead lion. Now, part of his vow was not just about his hair. Part of his vow was not to touch anything dead. And he did. And he ate the honey that was in this corpse. So he says to them, I got a riddle for you. Riddle me this, riddle me that. And he has this riddle, and he makes a bet with these men of Timnah at the wedding feast. And he says, you'll never be able to solve this. And he gives them a riddle about something strong and something sweet. So they come to his wife and they said, find out when you're on the honeymoon and tell us what his riddle means and we'll have the secret of his power. We'll pay you big money for the riddle answer. So she tries to wear him out and tell him, ask him, just you know, and the Bible says a continual dripping is like a nagging woman in a white house. You ever heard of faucet dripping that just drives you crazy? So it drip, 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 and finally he says, okay, tells her the secret, and he goes to the men of Timnah the next day, and they, sure enough, tell him, well, what is stronger than a lion, and what's sweeter than honey? And he gets furious. Now his strength is working, but it's not anointed strength. Now he's just using his own gifting for the wrong reason. And he gets up, and he's vexed. He's upset. He makes this comment, and I don't, listen, man, if you're going to develop some sense of your language, make sure you speak well of your wife at all times. He makes this statement. You can read in the scripture. He said, if you had not plowed with my heifer, you would never have known my riddle. Calls his wife a cow. You hadn't plowed with my heifer, you'd never known the answer to my riddle. You got to be careful how you talk about people, especially people you love. Amen. It's got quiet in here all of a sudden. I heard an amen only on the online campus right then. I know you men have never gotten yourselves in trouble by saying the wrong thing. We'll just keep moving. But Samson, he now goes and satisfies his bet with them, and he kills a whole bunch of men. He promised them all this massive amounts of new clothing. So he goes to another city and kills the population of the men of the city and brings their clothes back to the Timnites and gives it to them. And so mad with his wife, he goes back to his parents' house for a while. A few weeks later, he sees the error of his ways, and he comes back with gifts. And he comes to his wife's parents' house and he says, listen, I came to apologize to my wife. I've got gifts for her. And her father says, what are you doing here? I can't believe you're back. We thought you hated her and she married your best man. This is a story. This is Bible. This is like, you know, Search for Tomorrow. I mean, I don't even know what the soaps are on today, but that used to be one in the day. The Young and the Listless. I don't know. It was this guy. I mean, this could be a movie today. He comes back and he's brokenhearted. He's so brokenhearted. And this is where the ASPCA, the animal rights people, would be really upset, because what Samson did, the Bible says he went and found as many foxes as he could. And he tied their tails together, two of them at a time, and put a flaming torch on their tails and sent them into the city and burned the city to the ground, destroyed the Timnites. And the men of the city came and killed his wife and her whole family. Now he's gone from hurt and pain to more hurt and more pain, and he is upset. This pattern. He goes to another city, sleeping with a prostitute. Go to another city, it's another one. Go into another city, it's another. You can see it. And until he finds Delilah and winds up with the worst haircut of his life. Because part of the secret of his vow was he wasn't supposed to have his locks shaven or shorn. And it just, the Bible says she lulled him to sleep on her lap. Can I tell you how many great men and women of God have fallen asleep on the lap of Delilah? You know, Delilah's name means weakness. Here's the guy who's gifted. His gift, his superpower, his anointing from heaven is supernatural strength and power to make a difference for God and lead the people of Israel and protect them. But he falls asleep on the lap of a woman named weakness. And I don't know how it happened, but she She showed her hands way before. She said to him, hey, tell me the secret of your power. And he made up a lie. And the next day the Philistines came acting upon the lie, and he defeated them. Wouldn't you have enough sense, do you think, if it happened once and then happened again twice? Once, twice, three times she wasn't a lady. Delilah now still vexes him, messes with him, does the same thing that his wife and Timna did. How many of you know the devil's not creative? He just keeps repeating himself over and over again till you keep falling in the same dumb trap. And that's exactly what Samson did. He falls in the same dumb trap, and he winds up losing his power, being defeated by the enemy, and he's grinding, the Bible says, at a mill and walking around pushing a millstone around for the Philistines, and they plucked his eyes out. He loses his vision. The greatest thing, the redemptive thing about God that you need to know is that that wasn't the end of the story. The end of the story, he had led Israel for 20 years. And he did die a slave to the Philistines with no vision. But keep in mind the greatest redemptive verse in the entire Old Testament. Judges 16:22. However, the hair of his head began to grow again after it had been shaven. His covenant relationship with God began to grow again. And one translation said, as soon as they shaved his head, immediately his hair began to grow back. Aren't you glad that God loves you so much that even when you mess up, he's still going to allow you to finish strong? The Bible says that Samson, at the end of his life, pushes the walls of the city, the pillars of the city, down and destroys the Philistines and had more influence and power in his final act than he did his entire life. He ended up still protecting Israel because God is a redemptive God. Even under the old covenant, even under the law, even under this time before there was grace, before Jesus had even gone to the cross, Samson still finished strong. If you don't believe it, read Hebrews 11, because he's in the Faith Hall of Fame, Hebrews 11:32, where it says, and time would not even permit me to talk about these other great people who did great things for God, like Samson and Gideon and Barak and Jephthah. Understand, in this world, it's not how you start, but it's how you finish. It's not even how you're doing in the middle. It's how you finish. Say amen. Amen. If Samson finished strong after all that story, so can you. God's grace through Jesus Christ in the New Testament, we have a better covenant with better promises, right? Every human being is born with social needs. You are made to love and be loved. You are made to have friends and friendships and understand that some of them will be lifelong covenant relationships. Family is family. Understand, in this life, you were not born to go through life alone. You're not born to be a lone ranger, and you were not born again to be isolated and off by yourself in some corner watching Christian TV or YouTube. It is about relationships. It is about community. It is about doing life together and doing it well and working through disagreements, working through challenges, working through shame, working through moments where you went to the wrong place. But you can come back to the right place at the right time. Everybody needs people. We need each other. Whether you think so or not right now, at this stage of your life, it's part of authentic destiny. God has a tribe for you of divine relationships that you have to protect. The enemy wants you to be attracted to Timnah and Gaza. The enemy wants you to keep going to the valley of Sorek. And it's interesting that most of the places where the Bible says about Samson, it says, and he went down to those places. He went down from his calling, from his position, to find friends in low places. People will encourage you to walk with God if you'll let them. You can be around divine relationships where people will urge you to stand up and fight for your convictions and won't be continually talking to you or talking you into these compromising positions. But you got to surround yourself with the right people, and you got to have enough sense to know when the alarms are going off in your spirit that some relationship isn't right, you got to back away. Can I tell you that nobody fell into adultery like, oops? Most affairs begin with emotional affairs. Emotional. Sharing your heart with the wrong person. Sharing your heart with people that you're not in covenant with. I'm all about conversation. But let me tell you something. The only pillow talk I have is with this girl right over here on the front row. 38 years later, and she still agreed to be my wife. We're going over 38 more, okay? We re-upped. Next month is the 40th anniversary of our first date. We're going to be preaching up in Cape Cod in Massachusetts next month, the weekend before anniversary. And I'm just so excited about it. I can't believe 40 years it's been like that. I mean, that summer before I met her, I was a confused boy. And when I met Gail Patrick, my life began to turn for the good. She said to me, are you a Christian? I said, why do you ask? She said, because I can only go out with Christians. I said, yeah, I'm a Christian. I'm the most Christian guy you want to. I go to church. I did. I went to church. Didn't know Jesus, but I went to church. I thought, hey, you know, we live in America, Christian country, right? I'm not of another religion, and my parents are Christians, and we go to church. Yeah, I'm a Christian. Be careful to claim to be Christians for the wrong motives. Ladies. Well, she thought she'd change me quickly. It took 40 years. Let's put it that way. I'm still changing, still growing. It's just, there's still hope. It's not about just having friends for the sake of having friends that I'm talking about this month. I'm talking about having the right friends who will speak the truth in love. Those that see our blind spots and can help us see them without slamming them in our face. Having godly friends helps you stay on course. I'll finish with this. How many of you are slow drivers? You're just very cautious. How many cautious drivers we have in the room? Cautious drivers, okay. How many lead feet do we have? Just be honest about it. There's no police looking except online. Okay, just lead foot, okay. All right. Let me ask you a question. Those of you especially with the lead foot. How many drive a little different when there's a policeman behind you? We all do. Even you slow drivers. By the way, slow drivers, we're for you. Just get out of the left lane, please. Just get out of the left lane. That's just personal pet peeve. Not in the Bible, just personal preference. I've been driving a lot this week. Understand in this life, friendships where you have actual accountability are like moving life with the policeman behind you. You drive a little better. You don't get distracted with texting. You're not all over the lanes, and you're not going too fast or too slow. Why? Because when that comes, we're trained that way. When the policeman's behind you, you're going to drive a little better. Now, you should drive that way all the time as if the policeman's behind you. You should live life with divine relationships of people that love you enough to tell you the truth sometimes. I mean, tell you the truth all the time, but I mean point out the truth sometimes. To be able to say, you know what? I feel you drifting. I feel like you're going a little too fast right now. You're going a little too slow right now. We all need those balancing partners in our lives. And I don't mean just in marriage. I mean your family, your friends, relationships, church relationships, where we can move through this life together, do life together, and reach the other side in victory and in destiny, and not in compromise and lack and scandal. The Bible says all that story about Samson is written for our benefit. It's written so we can see those kinds of stories, because I'm telling you, friends, Samsons are all over our community today. Angry. His sin wasn't just lust. His sin was never dealing with the anger and the frustration of all the pain of his past, and kept dragging it right on into the future by getting back, going to the wrong places with the wrong people and doing the wrong things. May God give us this month wisdom and revelation and understanding that when we're going to do life well, we've got to walk with the wise and not spend so much time. Listen, there's plenty of fools that we can spend time with to win to Christ and win for wisdom. Building a relationship with lost people. I'm not saying don't do that. We have to build relationship with lost people, but they're not your inner circle. They're not your influence, you're theirs. Amen. Amen? May God give us the grace to move forward, to stay out of Timnah, Gaza, and Sorek, and to be with the people that have fruit, that have proof, that have over time shown themselves to be in our lives for our best interest, to keep urging us to go forward. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for your word today. Lord, this month, Holy Spirit, would you come and apply your wisdom to our hearts? Would you come and give us right relationships? Would you give us the courage to break free from the knuckleheads? Would you give us the courage and the wisdom to set some people free so we can get free? Would you help us, Holy Spirit, to be attracted to the right things and the right people and the right places? Lord, your word says that your people, you said that the steps of a righteous man are ordered of God. Lord, we ask you to help us to be attracted, that we can be at the right place at the right time, every time. Lord, I ask you to bring healing to every hurt. Lord, for anyone that's been spiraling, anyone that's begun the destructive patterns of Samson, today, would you just deal with the root? Would you come and help heal our hurts and our angry hearts and the bitterness that we feel? Lord, we choose forgiveness of others, but we ask you to forgive us. Cleanse us, Holy Spirit, and help us to have the right friends, the right relationships, that you would confirm your word in our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. I hope you received that today. God wants to do something great in your life. Ushers, go in and take your places, if you will, and get those out there. Today, before you leave, I want to encourage you. One of the greatest things you can do, one of the things I love about our conference every year, this is my 12th straight year at Wave Conference. Those of you that have been here for a while, you know that I'm on the executive board. Been part of that now for over 10 years. And just a great thing. I feel so good when I get with my tribe of other pastors from around the world. This year, we had a new pastor from Goa, India, who's got a huge ministry dealing with human trafficking. And I got to sit with him and hear stories about what God was doing there. And I'm looking forward to being able to sow a seed from Now Church into Goa, India soon. I met people from all over the world. There were people visiting for the first time in our conference from Uganda that helped to raise up the Watoto Children's Choir from Uganda. They're connected with our network out of Virginia Beach. Just all kinds of relationships. You know, one of the ways you know and you can be excited about where God is taking you is when you start seeing who he's surrounding you with and who he's given you opportunity to run with. I love being with God's people. I love being with those that are that have bigger churches or stronger churches, or they're just stronger preachers, or just better people than we are. And I just want to be around. I want to affiliate with the wise. You know what? I just said, God, I don't want to. You know, we all have insecurities, don't we? I said, God, I don't want to be insecure. Help me to be around people that have bigger worlds than I do, so you can enlarge my steps and enlarge my life. I think that's a big part of the message this month too, is that we just want to have a bigger world. And the Bible says that the generous person, the world of the generous gets larger and larger. The world of the stingy gets smaller and smaller. I want a big world. How about you? Amen. Let's pray right now as we prepare to give and trust God with our tithes and our offerings. Father, we thank you for your word today. Today we present our hearts to you in this final moment of worship. This is not a separate act. This is where we are, Father, and we sow a seed today into wholesome relationships, into relationships, great relationships for our children and our children's children. Lord, we pray for the generations after us that you would keep the evil away from them. Let our children be attracted only to the right friends and the right relationships. Lord, would you redefine cool and what it is to be cool in the eyes of our children and our grandchildren, even in ourselves. Help us to be around the right people and place value upon that. Today we present our hearts by giving you what you said is already yours. You said the tithe is yours. It's already holy. It belongs to you. So we pay our tithes today in faith. We give our offerings, but you said, see if I will not open for you the windows of heaven and pour out such blessing there won't be room enough to contain it all. Holy Spirit, build right relationships through this place, in this room, and through our online campus. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Amen. You receive that today? Go ahead and sow your seed. Listen, if you don't know Jesus, this is the moment. You don't have to wait till end of a service, to the very set last second. You don't have to come up to the altar right where you are. Receiving Christ, the prayer that I prayed is, Jesus, if you're real, show me. I say yes. I was about 19 years old, just turned 19, and I just said, yes, Jesus, yes, if you're real, God, show me. I want to know. And I began to cry out to God. I wasn't in a building, but God heard my prayer, and he hears your prayer today. That's the main thing. Jesus said, I call you servants, but I also call you friends if you listen to what I'm telling you to do. Amen. Stand up on your feet right now. Let's go out with some praise. Let's go out with some worship. Let's go out honoring him and blessing him. Come on, clap your hands again like you did a few moments ago, and let's honor the Lord. Come on.
7 o'clock, we're going to continue on in our series, Words to Live By. This time, Pastor Richard has a message. It is called, All Word, Dry Up, All Spirit, Blow Up. All word and spirit, grow up. What's that dealing with? It's dealing with your spiritual balance, being spiritually balanced in your life, and all of us need that. So make sure that you're here at 7 o'clock, and also remember, next steps, we're starting this next round, this next service. So it's all about no side, no God's going to be great. So be blessed. Have a great week. Hopefully see you Wednesday. Have a great week.
Updates, visit us at nowchurch.com, including live or on-demand video, event registration, online giving, and much more. And don't forget to follow Now Church on our social media platforms, including Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. And please use the hashtag NowChurch. Thank you